Sponsored by Wondrium. In the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verse 25, Jesus says, "It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God." This is one of the most famous sayings of Jesus. Not only is it quoted by the later Gospels of Matthew and Luke, but it echoes through literature for centuries to come, appearing everywhere from the Quran to even the works of Shakespeare. The saying also paints a vivid mental image. The average dromedary camel, the one-humped species of camel you see everywhere in the Middle East, weighs between 300 and 600 kilograms and can measure over 2 meters tall. Meanwhile, here's a sewing needle discovered south of Jerusalem that roughly dates to the lifetime of Jesus. Assuming that this needle is anywhere close to average, the eye of a Jesus-era needle measures about 3 millimeters wide and 7 millimeters long. So, unless you have the gravitational field of a neutron star capable of collapsing the mass of a camel into a tiny pinprick, what Jesus is suggesting is impossible. And that's kind of the point. Jesus is saying that it's impossible for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. But is this what the passage really says? There are 2 scholarly sounding theories floating around the internet that claim to unlock a hidden meaning of the text. And today we're going to examine those theories. Let's get into it. The first theory focuses on the camel, basically arguing that the original saying did not involve a camel at all, but rather a thick rope or cable used for boats. This theory thus suggests that the original saying was, "It is easier for a cable to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God." And because of a sloppy scribal error, the word rope or cable was swapped for the word camel when the scribe was copying the text. See, the Greek word for camel in this passage is kamelos. That middle vowel is the Greek vowel eta, but there's another very similar sounding Greek word, kamelos, as in rope or cable. Only one letter separates this word from camel, the Greek vowel iota instead of eta. Some have argued that the original saying must have used the word for rope, but some ancient scribe mistakenly mixed up the word for camel, swapping one little vowel for another. This new reading then became the mainstream version, and thus changed the phrase forever. On the surface, this is not unreasonable speculation. Ancient copyists made similar mistakes all the time in antiquity. For example, in Greek papyri found in Egypt, you'll frequently find scribes accidentally swapping the Greek vowels omega and omicron, which suggests the vowels sounded the same during the Roman period. The Greek language also underwent something that scholars call yotacism, which refers to the process of vowel pronunciations converging to eventually sound the same, especially the vowel eta shifting to sound like iota. Thus, by the Byzantine era, these 2 words likely sounded the same, which was potentially a big deal in the business of copying Bible manuscripts. Switch the wrong letter and you could accidentally change the meaning of a sentence. And some early Christian authorities noticed the similarities between these 2 words and assumed that rope/cable was the correct interpretation. The Bishop Cyril of Alexandria, writing in the 5th century, said, "By camel, Jesus means not the living thing, the beast of burden, but the thick rope to which sailors tie their anchors." Modern proponents of this theory agree with Cyril and make 2 main arguments. First, they argue the word rope makes more logical sense in context. Usually, you'd string a tiny piece of thread through the eye of a needle, so using the word rope makes for a more natural hyperbolic analogy than camel, which seems pretty random. Moreover, if this Greek word specifically refers to a nautical type of rope used for boats, then this reading also makes more sense alongside all the boat and fishing imagery that Jesus uses in the Gospel. Some make a second, not necessarily related argument, that rope makes more sense if we assume a Greek-speaking scribe was translating from Aramaic, the native language of Jesus. As in other Semitic languages like Hebrew and Arabic, written Aramaic uses only consonants. Thus, the word for camel, gamla, was spelled using the Aramaic equivalents of G, M, and L, and you're supposed to infer the vowels. These Aramaic-first theorists claim that the word for rope also used the root GML, and was pronounced like gamla, and a Greek-speaking scribe mistranslated the word as camel when copying from a hypothetical Aramaic version of the saying. However, there are several problems with this cable, not camel theory that make camel the much more likely reading. First of all, our earliest and best manuscripts say camel, not cable. When piecing together the original text of the New Testament, scholars favor our earliest manuscripts because they're the least likely to have undergone significant change over the course of centuries and centuries of copying. Now, admittedly, a small handful of much later Byzantine manuscripts do substitute cable for camel, but these are much more likely to be later changes, possibly even the result of later copyists attempting to soften the language of the original saying, as the scholar Bruce Metzger argues. Cable theorists thus not only argue against the majority of gospel manuscripts, but they also argue against the earliest gospel manuscripts. Based on the manuscript evidence, camel is the most likely reading. Secondly, there's a parallel idiom in the Jewish rabbinical text, the Babylonian Talmud, that uses the metaphor of an elephant going through the eye of a needle. The New Testament scholar Craig Keener argues this may suggest that Jesus was employing a common figure of speech used among Jewish teachers. When you want to say something is impossible, you use the metaphor of a large land animal going through the eye of a needle. In these cases, the camel being the largest land animal in the Levant and the elephant in Mesopotamia, where it still used to roam back in antiquity. Ironically, the Babylonian Talmud was composed in Aramaic, which undercuts the theory that some Greek-speaking copyist mistranslated a hypothetical Aramaic version of the saying, which leads us to the final problem. The claim that the Aramaic word for rope and camel shared the same root during the time of Jesus is simply false. The word for camel in 1st century Aramaic was indeed gamla, but the only source for gamla, also meaning a thick rope, does not appear until the 10th century CE, 1,000 years after Jesus. It appears in the work of the Syriac linguist Hassan Barbahlul. He wrote a big Syriac and Arabic dictionary, and in his entry on gamla, he included a supplementary edition where he says it can also mean a thick rope which is used for binding cargo ships. He then goes on to cite the exact same passage from Cyril of Alexandria from before. This definition of gamla appears nowhere else in Aramaic literature. Seriously, go check your favorite Aramaic dictionary. The Dictionary of Judean Aramaic by Michael Sokoloff, the Dictionary of Jewish-Palestinian Aramaic of the Byzantine period by Michael Sokoloff, or the Dictionary of Jewish-Babylonian Aramaic of the Talmudic and Gaonic periods by Michael Sokoloff, and you will not find a single entry for the word gamla, meaning rope or cable. The fact that Hassan Barbahlul includes it as a supplemental entry implies it was either a very rare use of the term, or he was engaging in his own exegesis, relying on Cyril and the confusion of the two words in Greek, which went on to influence Bible translations used by churches in the Syriac tradition, many of which follow his exegesis and translate the verse as rope. But he was writing in classical Syriac, also known as Syriac Aramaic, a different version of the language that Jesus spoke and one that was spoken hundreds of years after Jesus. As the Aramaic translator Steve Caruso says, this would be like claiming that a rare American meaning of a modern English word was known to someone speaking Anglo-Saxon back in the 10th century. Absurdly unlikely. However, although the boat cable interpretation is unlikely, it ultimately does not matter that much because it doesn't change the core meaning of the saying. It's equally impossible to pass a cable or a camel through the eye of a needle, though the latter is a much more comically absurd example. The second theory, on the other hand, fundamentally changes the message. This theory focuses on the needle, saying that the eye of the needle is actually a nickname referring to a small pedestrian gate in the walls of Jerusalem. While most gates would be large enough to allow large pack animals like horses, donkeys, and camels to pass in and out of the city, it'd be difficult to squeeze a camel through this pedestrian gate. Some versions of this theory envision a double gate, a large gate with a smaller pedestrian gate built into it, enabling pedestrians to pass through without needing to open the main gate. Gate theorists say Jesus was thus tailoring his proverb to his Jewish audience, with a specific, vivid, and local example. But is this theory true? Well, no, not at all. Not a single ancient source uses the phrase eye of a needle to refer to a gate in the wall of Jerusalem. Not a single biblical or extra-biblical source. Not Josephus, not the Dead Sea Scrolls, nothing in early Christian gospel commentaries, nothing in the rabbinic writings of the Mishnah or the Talmud, no evidence at all. The New Testament scholar Richard T. France calls it romantic speculation that unfortunately is sometimes treated as established exegesis. The legend rose in popularity in the 19th century, and it's repeated today by Christian pastors and TikTok influencers alike. So the next question is, where did this unsubstantiated theory come from, and how far back does it go? Well, lucky for us, a recent peer-reviewed article published by an actual biblical scholar traces its origins. In the June 22 issue of the journal New Testament Studies, the scholar Agnieszka Zimenska argues that this theory stretches back at least to the medieval period. The trail starts with William Shakespeare himself, who alludes to the theory in Richard II, Act 5, Scene 5. It is as hard to come as for a camel to thread the postern of a needle's eye, a postern being a secondary door in defensive fortifications. So apparently the legend was widespread enough in 16th century England for Shakespeare to casually drop it into one of his plays. It also appears over 100 years earlier in the writings of John Polliner, a European pilgrim who visited Jerusalem in the early 1420s. There he claims to have witnessed the actual gate. On the same street is a small door to the south, which in their language is called the eye of a needle, of which the Lord said, "It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle." Now, this is a very interesting eyewitness account that pilgrims had already associated the legend with a specific gate in Jerusalem by the 15th century. Though, if you know anything about Holy Land pilgrimage sites, they're often not based on hard evidence. These pilgrims were going off of what appears to be an earlier medieval tradition. The trail continues into the 13th century, when the theologian Thomas Aquinas composed the Golden Chain. This was basically a collection of earlier gospel commentaries discussing each verse of the four gospels. In this text, we find an anonymous annotation commenting on Matthew 19:24, one of the three mentions of the camel and needle saying in the New Testament. The annotation says, "There was a certain gate in Jerusalem, which is the eye of a needle. It was said, through which a camel, unless on bended knees, having laid aside a burden, could not pass." Thomas Aquinas attributes this passage to the monk and theologian Anselm of Canterbury, which would date the comment to the 11th or 12th century. And that's where the trail ends. The earliest reference to a gate of Jerusalem, nicknamed the Eye of the Needle, is from a medieval gospel commentary. So, what do we make of this? The complete absence of this legend from any ancient source, plus its sudden explosion in popularity between the 11th and 16th centuries, makes it much more likely that this legend is a medieval fabrication. What's interesting, though, is that this legend fundamentally changes the core message of the saying. If we take the plain meaning of the text, Jesus says it's impossible for rich people to attain salvation, and implies in the following verses it would literally take an act of God to save them. Which might make some people feel uneasy, and it's even possible that the legend grew in popularity precisely because it softens this harsh message, turning it into the much more palatable interpretation that if you just set aside the burdens of wealth, like a camel shrugging off its cargo, you can enter the kingdom of God. Zimenska concludes that this was a centuries-long effort to undermine the radical meaning of Jesus' hyperbole. In her words, "The statement is radical, and maybe should remain so." Thanks to Wondrium for sponsoring this video. If you're watching Religion for Breakfast, chances are you're a fan of educational content. I know I am, and I follow a bunch of educational channels here on YouTube, which is why I'm also a big fan of Wondrium. It's an online platform with a ton of educational content on basically every topic you can imagine, including some pretty niche topics, like a 24-lecture-long series on the science of gardening, taught by a professor of horticulture at Washington State University. Personally, I think it's pretty cool that professor of horticulture is a real job title. So Wondrium is for the super nerds among us who want long-form content on really interesting topics taught by actual experts. And as a religious studies academic myself, I'm constantly keeping tabs on their religion content. One of their newest series basically answers the question, why is Christianity the largest religion on earth and not another ancient religion like Manichaeism? The series is called The Triumph of Christianity, and it's taught by the scholar Dr. Bart Ehrman, whom I've interviewed on Religion for Breakfast before. He walks us through topics like the rule of Emperor Constantine and the exponential growth of Christianity during the Roman Empire. If you'd like to sign up, Wondrium is offering a free trial to the Religion for Breakfast audience. Head on over to wondrium.com/religionforbreakfast or click the link in the comments below. Thanks, everyone.